Hey folks, welcome to another Triple T Thursday. For those just joining us, that's Tools, Tips, and Talk, where we'll discuss info for the knife maker. In today's episode, we're going to talk about hydraulic presses. I had a couple questions in my Patreon group, so I wanted to answer those, and I figured I would just make a whole episode all about hydraulic presses. So the first question I get all the time is, should I get a hydraulic press or a power hammer? And of course, it would be great to have both. They each have their own uses. So first, hydraulic presses are great at setting welds and pressing things where you want continuous pressure all the way across the workpiece. As opposed to a hammer is going to strike in certain areas. It's great for drawing things out and for forging. It's a hammer. Unless you have a massive hammer like Salem Straub that has 13-inch dies, the typical hammer is not something you normally like set forge welds with when doing Damascus. I know folks like my friend Rick Hall, who has both power hammer and a hydraulic press, always sets his welds with the hydraulic press because he can press the entire billet down with the press. The other things about hydraulic presses, when you press on something, you have continuous contact with the workpiece and this big thick piece of metal. It's going to draw the heat out of that workpiece quite quickly. You're only going to get a couple of presses on each heat, as opposed to a power hammer that's only going to contact the workpiece for a millisecond. You can spend quite a bit of time with your workpiece in a power hammer. In fact, you can even generate heat with the power hammer just from the strikes. So that's kind of cool. But again, both have their own uses. And if I had to pick one, I would get a hydraulic press just because I think they're a bit more versatile. And for me, the only reason I don't have a power hammer as well as the press is I live in a neighborhood and the power hammer is just too loud. And fun fact, I actually built a power hammer, a tire hammer, before I built my hydraulic press. I used it for a few days and realized it was way louder than I thought it was going to be. It shook the foundation in this house. The next question I get is, what kind of press should I buy? So let's talk about the kinds of presses. Really, there's two main types of presses or designs. There's the H-frame, which is what I have, and I'm going to show you in a minute. It's very sturdy and it's very easy to build. You can get a relatively small press in an H-frame style that can still have quite a high tonnage, as opposed to a C-frame, where you get access to your workpiece from about 270 degrees around the press, which is really nice. But because of that design, they have to be built quite a bit bigger to make them more rigid, so they'll be able to deal with that much pressure. Coal Ironworks makes a great 25-ton press in the C-frame design. Both are great. They have their pros and cons. Like I said, it's easy to build. It's a simple design to build an H-frame. So if you're building one yourself, that's what I always recommend. And then the C-frames have an advantage that you can kind of walk around them. I will mention log splitter hydraulic presses, which I'm not a big fan of. A log splitter is not meant, it's meant to split wood. It's not meant for the stresses that forging and pressing metal are going to put on the frame. The frames just aren't built for that typically. So you're going to have to be reinforcing it and basically jerry-rigging it more than what it's meant to do. So I always tell people, unless you're getting the log splitter for free, don't do that. You're much better off getting the components, which are basically around the same price as to buy a log splitter new. Go buy the components and build an H-frame. You'll be much better off. You'll have a better press in the end, and you'll be happier. So the next question is, how big of a press should I get? And presses are rated in tons, meaning the amount of pushing force that the cylinder, the hydraulic cylinder, has. And that's a bit misleading because just because you have a really big cylinder, it doesn't mean that you're going to get a lot of pressure pushing down on the workpiece. So the way I would explain it this way is where the cylinder will exert force, meaning how much force it can press, the size of your dies are going to determine how the metal moves and how much pressure, because pressure is force exerted over an area. So if you have a 12-ton press, but you have four by four inch dies, those are pretty huge dies, you're not going to move a lot of metal. Okay. If you had a 25-ton press and 2-inch by 2-inch dies, you're going to move a lot of metal. It's going to mushroom around those dies quite a bit. So you would probably have to be very careful on something like that. And when we get into talking about dies and shapes of dies, we'll talk more about that effect. So really all it means is the smaller the press you get, you're just going to have to shrink your dies and make them comparable to the tonnage of your press. Meaning the reverse of that, the larger the press you get, the larger the dies you can get. So really it's just a matter of how fast do you want to get the work done. Okay, with a 25 or a 30 ton press, you're going to be able to have larger dies, you're going to move more metal with each press. So there's a lot more to presses than just, you know, get the biggest RAM that you can. RAM meaning hydraulic cylinder. There's other issues involved as well. So let's talk about how does a press work. So a hydraulic press works by a hydraulic cylinder that uses oil, and it's basically got two inlets. One that pushes oil that moves the cylinder, the piston down, and oil flowing the other way, which pushes the cylinder up. You have a valve that's going to control the flow of that oil, whether it's going in the top or it's going in the bottom, meaning it's pushing the cylinder up or down. So you need a valve, okay? And then how fast the oil is going. So how fast it's pushing oil into that cylinder. That is very, very important. There's no good having a 25-ton cylinder if you're moving the oil in so slowly that the dies only move 1/8 of an inch per second. That's not very good at all, because your workpiece is gonna cool by the time your dies compress it at all. So another really important fact is the pump, meaning the oil pump that's pumping oil into your cylinder. And what drives the pump is a motor. So for a 25-ton cylinder, I always recommend a 13-gallon-per-minute pump and a 5-horse motor to push enough of that oil fast enough. Because if you don't put a fast enough motor in your press, you're not going to be pushing enough oil, and the travel speed on the head of the press is not going to be fast enough. You want that thing to move at least 1 inch a second, preferably 1.5 to 2 inches per second. That's mine goes, I haven't measured it, but it's about 1.5 inches in a second. Let's go take a look at my press now and I'll show you all about it. So here's my press. It is an H-frame and it's sitting on legs with casters, so I can move it around. It's about 5 feet tall, and I did this for a reason, because I am 6'2". So one of the things I tell people when doing presses like this is consider putting the cylinder on the bottom instead of the top. Most people have this thing in their head that the press must press down. Whether it's pressing up or pressing down, it does exactly the same thing. It's just a mental thing for you to think that the die presses down, or sorry, presses up rather than down is weird. You'll get used to it in a matter of minutes. It really does not affect anything. Whether you sit your work on here and it presses it up, or you sit your work on here and this presses down, same thing. The reason I recommend it on the bottom is so that this is closer to your face, instead of you having to bend over and put your work down here because you've got the cylinder up here. And then all you're going to be doing is slouching over every time to be able to see what you're doing. I don't like that. I like having it up here. It's easy to see. My one complaint about the Cole Ironworks 25 ton is, for someone who's really tall, I find myself bending over the entire time that I'm using it. And I'm not a fan of that. It gives me back pain bending over for hours. So let's talk about the dies for this particular design. I made my die holders square. And the reason I did that is so that I could take the same die, turn it 90 degrees, and then have a different shape. And this is extremely useful. So every one of my dies I can turn 90 degrees. Very useful. I would recommend you do this if you're gonna make a press. It just means you make half as many dies as you need. Another thing that this press has is a foot pedal. And I am a huge fan of having the foot pedal because it means you can be doing something with each hand and still pressing. And that's really convenient if you need to do, you know, some kind of top tool or a kiss block or something like that with one hand and you're holding the work with another. Sometimes I've had work pieces that are just so heavy I need to move them around with two hands. So definitely put a foot pedal on your press. You will not regret it. If you need something to put in your press, definitely check out our sponsor, Maritime Knife Supply. They've got all the steel you need, in addition to all the knife making supplies, whether it's flux, epoxy, steel, handle material, you name it. Tools, equipment, everything you need for knife making, they've got you covered. All right, so let's talk about dies. One of the first dies you're gonna need is just flat dies. And of course, there's a pair. Each one of these comes in a pair. I'm only showing you one of them. The flat dies are super important. You know, obviously you're going to be doing like setting welds, forge welds, just compressing material that you're not trying to draw out. So these are really important. I will use these in this format when I'm setting a weld and when I'm drawing something, you know, and I'm pressing it down, but I don't want a lot of distortion, I will do this because there's, you know, my work pieces, because you're moving your work piece in and out like this, there's less contact, so you're going to get more pressure. As opposed to this, when you put your work piece here, there's more area. Remember, pressure and the amount of movement is going to be in relation to the size of your dies. And of course, you don't have to, you know, when you put your workpiece in, you don't have to put it over the whole die. You can just put it over half of the die, press that down, move it over, so then still only half of what's under your workpiece is getting pressed. So it's all about, you know, the amount of, the size of the bite that you're going to take. Then we come to drawing dies. This is the first drawing die I made. And the only reason why I don't like this one, it's just too aggressive. Because if you look here, it's so easy to press something and just press it right through and go way further than you want. So I call these my aggressive drawing dies. And these are much, much more gentle. And I tend to use these when I'm drawing out Damascus or I'm just trying to lengthen something. It's rare that I'll use this one. It also does more distortion because it's going to move things. If I'm trying to create distortion, like when I'm doing a layered construction, like copper Damascus, and I want those nice waves, I'll hit it every inch with these, and that'll give me that heartbeat pattern. So really important to have at least these two kind of dies. I will pause and talk about the material here. There is no reason to use like a tool steel, like H13 or something like that for dies for a hydraulic press. These are all mild steel. You don't have a lot of impact, okay? This is just pressure. So you don't need that kind. You will have to dress your dies for on occasion, like this. Obviously, I had something under here, and it's got some little nicks in here, but I can just grind this down. I've been using this one for 5 years, so these are the same dies, and just today, I just kind of surfaced it a little bit for the first time. One thing you're definitely going to need is kiss blocks. Sure, you can go the low-tech route of putting a known thickness steel on your die and pressing. That's kind of hokey. What I've done is create these little cradles or saddles. I've written the thickness on them. I can just sit these over top of my flat dies, just on the bottom. Put my workpiece in here, the top die is going to come down and it's just going to hit these. So I know if I want a bar that's 5/8 thick, I'll throw this kiss block on. And I've got these in various increments, all the way from, I think, 3/8 all the way up to an inch and a quarter, I think. But kiss blocks are really useful. You're going to want some of these. So the next die we're going to talk about is a squaring die. So this is really useful when you want to get something perfectly square. It's very easy when you're using a press or a power hammer to rhombus a billet, which means you're going to kind of get it on an angle. So it's like that, kind of tilted over a little bit. With squaring dies, you're sure, because this is 90 degrees, you're sure that it's going to stay square. Plus, when you have one coming from the top and this coming from the bottom, you're actually pushing in four directions, because as you press down, it's exerting force this way on the billet. So this is really great for doing canisters and compressing canisters, because it compresses all four sides at the same time. Next up, just some utility dies. This is a punch. Really, it's a set because your workpiece will go in here. This is for doing usually hammers and axes. You want to punch the hole. So then you're going to punch down, and as you pull up, these bars will knock the piece off so it doesn't stick to your punch. So those are really useful. And of course, we've got a splitter for doing feather Damascus. And this is just a big hunk of steel that I drive through a piece to create the feather pattern. And then there's some more specialized dies. This is a chevron pattern die, kind of like doing ladder Damascus, but for this I want a fancy chevron pattern. My buddy Tony Saverio's got a great video that he just released on making ladder dies, so I'll put a link up in the corner. You can go check that out. I think I'm going to make some using his method. So there's other fancy things you can get for presses that kind of bling it out, so to speak. We talked about kiss blocks. You can actually get limiters that instead of kiss blocks, you just have little kind of switches, and as the press goes up, it hits the switch and then it stops. And you can just align these switches instead of having kiss blocks for your press. So that's a nice upgrade. Blackbeard Projects did a video on setting one of these up, so go check that out. Lastly, you can get computer controlled presses. Cole Ironworks sells a automated computer controller for a press, so you can set it not only for setting things like kiss blocks and things, but you can have it set so that it's going to go press, 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 and then stop, or it'll go press, press, press really fast. Like, you can set anything that you want it to do, whether it's going to be press, 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 press at a certain distance, and then start pressing an eighth of an inch deeper. So it's really cool. It kind of turns your press kind of in an automated power hammer, because you have all of this control, but they're not cheap. So go look at Cole Ironworks. I think they're only set up to work on their machines as well, but some fancy technology out there, and I wouldn't mind having one just to play with, but pricey. Thanks for joining me, folks. I hope you got something out of today's episode. Definitely check out our sponsor, Maritime Knife Supply, for all of your knife making needs. Thanks for joining me, folks. We'll see you on the next one.